Back to a Bazaar morning call. Well, you know, the budget is hardly 10, 15 days away. So let's get some budget expectations going. A lower goods and services tax, clarity on rules, implementation of much needed policies. These are just a few of the things that auto dealers are looking for as Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman readies to present the budget this July. CNBC TV18's Alisha Sachdev has all the details.
The government wants India to rank among the world's top three manufacturers and exporters of automobiles. That, however, looks tough right now. Dealerships like this one have been reporting a drop in sales for the last 10 months. Add to that, the liquidity crunch that the sector is facing, which has led to quite a few of these dealerships shutting shop altogether, especially in metros and tier 2 cities.
Inventories have been given a breather with many automakers announcing production cuts, but the industry is still staring at a double-digit decline in sales in the near term, as a 20-quarter low in economic growth has meant demand remains muted.
If you look at car sales, till 2014, it always used to grow double the GDP growth. Mm-hmm. Okay. In last 5 years, if you look at 2014 or 15, 16, 17, 18, generally, it has grown at the rate of the GDP growth in India. So last 3 months, if you talk about, the sales are down by roughly 20% at an industry level.
This has many auto dealers hoping that the upcoming budget will bring some relief, starting with goods and services tax.
Currently, we do have the GST plus a very complicated method of the CESS, compensation CESS. It depends on length of the car, engine size of the car, petrol or diesel, and even the height of the ground clearance. It makes it actually really very confusing. I fail to understand why should there be so many various heads. I would expect that if the budget can just rationalize this to one or two different rates, it will be much simpler.
Even though the GST is, strictly speaking, beyond the budget's purview, there is hope that the groundwork for lower rates will be laid, which could fuel some demand. Dealers add that clear policies will also make their lives easier.
Our industry, our automobile, is not who is handling, which ministry is handling. It is industry ministry, it is under transport ministry. We require some franchises law, which everywhere in the world are present.
It is very important that vehicles which are pre-BS4, which are the BS3, BS2 or non-BS vehicles, they go off-road. The only way they can go off-road is if there is an incentive given to the owners of these vehicles to scrap these vehicles and only then buy new vehicles.
Dealers also hope there will be measures to clear up the bottlenecks when it comes to financing.
We definitely want that a special package should come in for NBFCs, where liquidity is not such a big concern and they can infuse funds in the market and give auto loans the way they were giving pre the ILFS collapse.
Now, a lot of these demands are not new. Auto manufacturers have already made their submissions to the finance minister, but car dealers who have been bearing the brunt of weak demand, rising inventory costs and a financing crunch hope their pain points will be addressed. In Mumbai, this is Soini Dutt with Alisha Sachdev for CNBC TV18.
All right, well, that is the auto sector struggling with the slowdown and looking out for a bit of a helping hand from the government. Let's move on now. Our next discussion focuses on an issue that India Inc. has been grappling with for some time now. At this time of sort of heightened scrutiny and talk of perhaps even bans taking place on the big four audit firms, the question is there some sort of a middle ground? What can be done to protect shareholder interests and rights further, and what is the real way forward? We have with us Mr. Jayan Gupta, former ED of SEBI, as well as Amit Tandon of IIAS. Gentlemen, good morning and thank you so much for joining in. I think the first time we sort of became sensitized towards, problematic auditor issues was way back in the Satyam scam. And well over a decade down the line with the ILNFS, the problems still persist. India now threatening to ban auditors. I just want to get your first thoughts in on whether a ban per se would really fix some of the issues from a shareholder protection standpoint. Amit, let's get your thoughts on the subject first.
This is a good morning. It's a fairly intractable issue. At the end of the day, we need to remember that the big four auditors audit about 65% of the top 500 companies. And of course, it's much lower than what you've seen in the US and UK, where it's upwards of 95%, but it's still a fairly high number. So the question is whether it is going to be disruptive. And that against that, you need to ask the question that have the big four audit firms been provided the assurance? Have they been providing the assurance which they've promised to provide all these years? So if the answer to the question is no, they haven't been providing the assurance, then we need a solution. If the answer to that question is yes, there have been providing the assurance, these are a few aberrations, in which case I would suggest that we need to put a fairly high fine on these companies and get on with life. Now, part of that could be that some of the audit partners could be banned. We need to understand how they're changing their processes and then continuing.
The problem is in this whole thing, the minority shareholder suffers the most. So, Mr. Gupta, I want to bring you in this conversation. Who does the investor really rely on? As Surbhi was saying, you know, there are these auditor management spats that are common. There are talks of perhaps banning the auditors, etc. There's now also this issue of rating agencies. I mean, DHFL recently claimed that its downgrade was unfair. What do you think is the need of the hour, and who should the investor trust?
See, it's a very, very complicated issue, and it can't be answered in one single sentence. But the very simple issue is this, that when an investor looks at numbers, when an investor looks at a rating, he is given to understand that these are the correct thing, and it gives portrait the correct picture. But unfortunately, when you have seen the past couple of months or years or maybe a decade, you find that many of these times the faith is shaken. Now, what is the reason for this shaken faith? It's simple, that many a times auditors have not played their role perfectly. But I would agree 100% with Amit that when, say, an auditor has not paid attention or not done thing 100% faithfully, doesn't mean that the entire firm or entire industry has not done it. There would be some black sheep, and banning the industry or banning a firm is not a solution. Similarly, credit rating agency, I have yet to understand a concept that how a credit rating agency can rate a single instrument of the company without rating the entire company, unless and until the instrument is guaranteed to be paid out of an escrow mechanism. So what I would say, that somehow or other structure itself is not correct. For example, when you see the numbers in an audited accounts, now for an investor the absolute numbers may matter, may not matter, because it doesn't give you a performance metrics that whether the company is going on a better way or bad thing, or how it is performing with its peers. So somewhere or other, we have to really look into what we need to give. The problem in our country is this, that we give so much information, but all useless information. Annual reports are 400 pages, prospectus are 500 pages, but what really the investor should look in or what information should get in is not there. As a result, what happens? Every brokerage house, every investor has to do analysis in its own way. It's a waste of manpower. If we can design an accounting system where performance parameters are defined and they are declared and management gives an explanation on each and everything, how the company is going forward. If you recall, SEBI LODR has made mandatory that few key parameters of or ratios should be given and management should explain. So that is a step in the right direction. But I would say the industry should get together. And second and more thing is that if you look at cash flow statement, I can't make any head and tail of the cash flow statement except that 100 is equal to 100. So somewhere people have to put their brains, mind and come together and say that every information that is given is meaningful. If you see in Indian judicial system, you file a charge sheet, you file a paper, 800 pages, 900 pages. So what happened? All the information is there, but information is hidden somewhere so that the judge also doesn't know, and most of the cases failed. So the issue is bring the relevant information in a manner where investor can understand it.
Couldn't agree more, sir.
We jumble up everything.
No, I couldn't agree more, sir. Absolutely. In fact, that is the question that I want to take forward. Amit, you know, between auditors, independent directors, rating agencies, you know, these entities are supposed to be the guardians of minority shareholder interest. But look what's happened in the last 1 year. I mean, clearly somewhere these systems and these institutions aren't working properly, because when do we get to know there's a problem with the company? When shares have lost 80-90% of their value, or when one fine day we wake up that the company is defaulted and now banks are going to take it to the NCLT. I mean, surely between the institutions that I named, there has to be a better way for shareholders to see the warning signs, the red flags early on. What should be done then, and really where does the blame lie?
Oh, absolutely. As you point out, the auditors, the rating agencies, the independent directors are all gatekeepers in a sense for the minority investors, because they are the people who are in the boardroom, within the management circles, circling around there, interacting with them, as against the investors who are kind of sitting outside and watching what is going on. So they have to play a far more responsible role. Partly it's because their understanding in terms of who their loyalties lie to. Partly it could be because of historical developments. Partly it's also, you know, if you kind of look at what has happened with the auditors, over a period of time, they've kind of changed the accounting rules so much that the whole element, it's kind of relying entirely on the judgment of the auditors. And there, as Charlie Munger, Warren Buffett's partners, has said, it's kind of completely unhinged from common sense. So I think this whole shift in accounting policy is responsible. And then if you speak to the auditors, they kind of say, yes, we have audited according to the accounting principles. I think we need to kind of take a step back and say that, look, the information which you're providing, and it holds for rating agencies as well. Independent directors is slightly different, but let's speak to these two. They have to kind of go back, look at the first principles, which is that, look, principles of prudence. Is it that what they're going to be telling people, is it going to be useful for the users? And if it is useful for the users, they're serving a purpose. If it is not useful for users, they need to go back and redesign their system. I agree with Mr. Gupta. We've kind of seen annual reports. One of the companies which has a large number of subsidiaries, I think it added up to about 1.5-2 feet. No one has the either the desire or the ability to go through that bit of information. You need to have information which is relevant, which is digestible, which is useful, which needs to be provided. And both sets, rather than become arcane, rule-driven, have a language of their own, they need to come and speak to investors in a language which they understand. I also have one other suggestion here, which is that, you know, oftentimes we try and speak to auditors and try and understand what's happening, and they kind of take a step back and say, look, client confidentiality, we cannot answer these questions. I think this whole dialogue between the investors and the auditors needs to step up quite significantly. I understand client confidentiality, but sometimes you're just wanting to understand some of the principles of accounting. How have you prepared these results? Why are they significantly different from one of the competitors or peers in the market? What is the difference in accounting standards? And of course, all the sets of players need to engage far more with auditors with regard to accounting policies themselves. It seems to be a fairly esoteric subject which no one wants to get involved in, but it has fairly far-reaching and it has fairly long-term consequences for the market.
Absolutely. We've run out of time, but thank you, gentlemen, for giving us your views. So more transparency, more disclosures, higher governance standards, and of course, more dialogue between the investors and the auditing team. That's a long wish list, but well, we have to start somewhere.